So, welcome to module 16. The topic today is the quotient constructions which are typical in algebraic topology. So, let us begin with the so-called cone construction. The subspace of R3, which is given by the equation x square plus y square equal to r square, no condition answered, is a vertical cylinder of radius r. Central axis will be the z axis. So this is a model for what we call infinite cylinder. Okay. You can restrict the coordinate z, say minus 5 to plus 5, then it will be a cylinder of height 10. All right. So you can, you know, z axis can be restricted to some extent. That's also cylinder. Okay. So what topologically what this one is, nothing but S1 cross an interval. The interval could be infinite length, finite length, closed interval or open interval. All these things are called cylinders. S1 cross J. So these are called actually circular cylinders in physics. Okay. So we will generalize this concept. You can call any space cross an interval as a cylinder, and the cylinder has x as a base instead of the circle. The x topological space cross 0, 1, you can think of this as a cylinder. Okay. Now, this kind of generalization we are going to do for what is known in layman's parlor or in physics, the usual definition of a cone. Okay, so in algebraic topology, we define the cone based on any topological space X. What we do, take X cross I. In fact, you can take any interval, but let us standardize to the unit interval, X cross I, and then identify X comma T with X comma 0. Or x comma 1, whatever, y comma t it should be, for all t not equal to 0. What is this happening here? X comma 0 is x comma t. X comma t is x comma t. No identifications where t is not equal to 0. But when t equal to 0, all x comma 0 is identified with y comma 0 for every x, y, and x. Okay, so this is the space. For t not equal to 0, the only identification is with itself. There is no identification. X comma t is x comma t. But on the base, namely x comma 0 in x cross I, every point is identified with every other point. So the entire x cross 0 is identified to a single point. This quotient space is called the cone over X. Okay. The point, namely the entire X cross 0, which identified to a single point, that's called vertex of the cone or apex of the cone. Okay. So you can just denote it by simply by star. The space X itself can then be identified with the image of X cross 1 on the top. Okay, that's a quotient space, and this then refers to the base of the cone. You can think of, to get an idea of cone, you can always think of X as S1, the circle. It could be, instead of circle, it could be ellipse also. So I guessed it could be a curve, and then you can talk about the cone over the curve. So this is what the generalization is about. Okay. So the base of the cone is the starting with the topological space. That is the base. but then that will be subspace of the cone via several ways, but I am taking in one particular way, namely x goes to x comma 1. So here is a picture. We start with x cross 0, and then the bottom x cross 0, x cross I here, bottom x cross 0 is completely identified to a single point here. Whereas x cross 1 can be thought of as the original x here. In fact, you could have put x cross half here, there will be a copy of x here also. In the picture, it will be somewhat shrunk, but it is homeomorphic to that copy. All x cross t not equal to 0, they will be homeomorphic to x itself, namely x going to x comma t. Right? This cone construction is very fundamental in homotopy theory. We will see why that is so important. So, for an arbitrary point of this cone over x, this is notation, can be represented in the form x comma t bracket, curly bracket, usual parenthesis would have been original thing. Now we have put square brackets for some x belong to x and t belong to I. Normally, square brackets will denote the equivalence classes. Okay. The representation being unique if t is not equal to 0. But for t equal to 0, any x comma 0 will represent the same point. Okay, so x comma 0 will represent the vertex 0 for all x. Though cx may not have any linear structure, it is not a vector space, but something nice happens, namely, it makes sense to talk about line segments through any point x comma t of cx and star. Passing through star, there are lines. What are they? Namely, the image of little x cross I. So that whole thing is there. It's actually homeomorphic to I itself. For each x comma t going to x comma t will give you a embedding of the interval I inside x cross I to again cx. Okay, so from star you can go to any other point of xt by a line segment. Okay, the points, what is the point? Sum of xt is there. You take x comma st. When s is 0, it will be the star. When x is 1, it will be your point xt. So this entire cone is star shaped in this sense. The star has fx. Okay. So this fx we have defined for any star shaped set. So here also we call it as fx. We call it as a vertex also, vertex of the cone also, that is also used. Okay, observe that the map xts going to x of st, okay, just we have taken that map here, defines the homotopy of the constant map star. Okay, when s is 0, it is a constant map. When s is 1, it is the identity map. So in particular, this gives you its contractible. Of course, you don't need this proof, because once something is star-shaped, we know that it is contractible. But that was in a vector space, so you better see what is the meaning of this one, but it's similar to that one. So cones are always contractible, irrespective of what the original space is. Suppose you take just two-point space, discrete space. What is the cone over it? It will be just union of two lines, okay? At one single point. Because 2 points cross I is union of disjoint union of two lines, two copies of I. But one of the point, namely at 0, both the points will be identified. So it will be again a line. All right. So that is contractible. X here with 2 points, it was not even connected. given any map f from x to y, you can talk about the cone of f. Namely, the map, corresponding map induced on cx to cy. It's a natural way to get a map on x cross I to x cross I, x cross I to y cross I, namely f of, you know, cf, whatever, x comma t goes to fx comma t, namely f cross identity. But then you can pass down to the quotients. So that is cf. Cf of xt is fx comma t. The second coordinate t part is not affected. Okay, it has the property that if you restrict it to x, namely x cross 1, then it is f. It can be identified with f. When you identify x with x comma 1, you can throw away that one, then it is just fx. So it is f. So x to y, you have a map. Cx and cy are larger spaces containing x and y. Then you can think of cf as an extension of f. Okay, extension of f for the cones over x and cone over x and cone over y. Okay, so this is what we will have this picture, namely x is sitting inside cx, y is sitting inside cy, namely x comma 1 and y comma 1 here. Okay, so one of the nice property of cf is that cf will be a homeomorphism if and only if f is a homeomorphism. So very easy to check. The more deeper thing here is that the cone construction is actually functorial. Okay, so if f from x to x is identity map, cf will be identity map. If x to y, y to z, you have maps. Okay, f and g, for example, g composite f will be from x to z. C of g composite f is cf composite cg composite cf. So that is the meaning of that the cone construction is actually a functorial map. It's like our pi 1. Pi 1 was what is it? It was a functor from a topological space to the groups. Here it is space to space itself, topological space to topological spaces. Okay. Now the usefulness of the construction, cone construction, will come into picture in studying the homotopy theory. Any topological space X is contractible if and only if the space is a retract of the cone. You know, cone itself is contractible always, but X itself is contractible if X is a retract of this one, and conversely. So this is the statement. Let us go through the proof of this. Take Q from x cross I to Cx, which is the quotient map, namely x cross 0 being identified as a single point. Okay, this is just notation for the quotient map. Suppose now you have a homotopy H from x cross I to X, such that it is the identity, it is the constant map at zeroth level and identity at the t equal to 1. So between zero, between the constant map and the identity map, H is a homotopy. Okay. Corresponding to this, there is a continuous map R from Cx to Cx, okay, defined by R of Xt is equal to H of Xt. R of the class Xt equal to H of Xt. You see, this should be independent of the class. So let us verify. If t is not 0, then xt is a single point. So it is h of xt, no problem. If t is 0, all this is independent of x, one single point. Okay. But h of xt depends upon x. But if t is 0, this is a constant map. Therefore, this is well defined. Okay. Not only is well defined, automatically this will be continuous because it's continuous on x cross I and it boils down to Cx. Remember, Cx is a quotient of it. It's a unique Q composite this, Q composite, R composite Q is H. Okay, that is how I have defined this. Okay, it boils down to the quotient space, Cx. Also, this R on x comma 1, namely the subspace x, it's identity because h of x1 is identity. Okay, so we have identified x with x cross 1. This is what we are using here. That is how we can talk about x as a retract of Cx. Okay, this is the meaning of retract if you want to recall it, namely a function from the whole space to the subspace, which is identity on elements of x. And R must be continuous. Okay, we have used the retracts earlier. We have shown that the disk D2, the boundary, namely S1, is not a retract of D2. We have shown that one in proving Brouwer's fifth point theorem. All right. So we have proved that if the constant map is homotopic to identity map of X, namely X is contractible, then X is a retract of Cx. Now let us look at converse. Suppose you have retraction Cx to X. Okay. Then you just define H of Xt by R of Xt by the same formula. Now, here I've used this one to define R. Now, if R is given, I am defining H. Okay, automatically H will have the property when T is 0, it is a single point, and T is 1, it is R of Xt by definition, it's R of X, which is X. Okay, so identity map. So, H gives you a homotopy of the constant map with the identity map of X. This is tautology here, right? Just I have used the fact that Cx is a quotient of X cross I, where all the X cross 0 is identified as a single point. And homotopy of the identity map to a single point also has this property. Therefore, everything works fine. Now, here is an example. Let us take the circle, more generally take any sphere. You can even take S naught also, okay? So take the sphere Sn minus 1, take the cone over that. That will be homeomorphic to the disk of one dimension IR. If you start with S0, the cone over that will be homeomorphic to the interval minus 1 to plus 1. If you take S1, this will be the disk D2. Okay, and so on. For n equal to 2, this is the familiar polar coordinates. Polar coordinates of complex members. Okay, R times cos theta sin theta. The cos theta sin theta is a point of S1. Okay. R corresponds to 0, 1. So S1 cross I, you can say. But when R is 0, it gives you one single point. So the entire S1 cross 0 is going to a single point. So that is a quotient map. Okay. So that's why the cone over Sn, S1 is D2. Okay, for n greater than or equal to 2, it is generalized polar coordinates. You can, when you have a vector, unit vector in Sn minus 1, namely in Rn a unit vector, okay, the rest of the Rn can be thought of as R times unit vector. When R is 0, it will give you just single point. For R not equal to 0, it's one oneness. Okay. So what we do, Sn minus 1 cross I to Dn, we just write x comma t going to t times x. This map is clearly continuous surjection and one-to-one except for points of the form Sn minus 1 cross 0, the entire thing is mapped to a single point. Therefore, this map P factors down to the cone over Sn minus 1 to Dn. This is a quotient map. So it gives you a map. This is a quotient space, CSN map. So P bar is a unique map defined by P. Okay. So P bar, Q composite P bar is P. Since the domain is compact, Dn is compact, C of Sn minus 1 is compact. Because Sn minus is compact, the product with I is compact, therefore the quotient is compact. So the domain is compact, and this is Hausdorff. Okay, continuous bijection is a homeomorphism. So this we keep using all the time. So we identify x cross 0 to a point. Okay, so we got an ice cream cone like that. You could have done x cross 1 also to a point, then you would have got a tent. Both of them are cones. Homeomorphically, all that you can, x comma t, you can change x comma 1 minus t, then you would get the other one. So there is no problem. In fact, what you can do is any interval also, I have told you. But we have just standardized these things so that again and again, you don't have to keep on changing coordinates. That's all. Now, let me tell you about another important construction called adjunction space. So pay attention to the definitions. You should not have any confusion in the definition. You start with a space and a closed subspace, Z. Z is a closed subspace of X. Okay, sorry, the other way around. Z is, X is a closed subspace of Z. Let us do that one. Let me stick to the notation that I have already introduced. Don't change it here. Let X be a closed subspace of Z, okay? Then the function is, there is a continuous map from X to Y. Y is another space. On the subspace, you have a continuous function. On this closed subset, you have a continuous function, okay? Now the adjunction space is defined as a disjoint union of Z and Y, okay? Modulo some relation. So it's a quotient of Z disjoint union Y modulo some relation. And I'm going to denote it by AF or Z union over F Y. So these are the notations for the final quotient space. It's going to be disjoint union of Y and Z. Then you have to make identification. What are the relations? Every point x in x will be identified with fx in y. X will be identified as image fx for every x in x. So this is the identification. Or no other point that are, you know, if z is a point not in x, then it is not identified with any other point. For all z is equivalent to z itself, that's all. All y is equivalent to y itself, there is no identification inside y. Okay, it is a point of y and a point of x. They are identified when, namely, y must be equal to fx. Then only those points are identified. Okay, this space is also called the space obtained by attaching the whole space Z to the space y via the map F. Okay, So this description of attaching this one, this will come very, very much into operation, maybe much later, in algebraic topology, when you study cell complexes and so on. Okay. Y can be identified with a closed subspace of AF, namely AF is an adjunction space, namely each Y being its class. There is no identification. Each Y itself is a class there. Okay, so that inclusion map from the disjoint union to the quotient space, okay, that will be a closed subspace. Why? Because the inverse image is just Y. It's disjoint union Y union set, that is closed here. See, disjoint union of two spaces, both Y and Z are closed subspaces. Okay, only thing is, we won't get a copy of Z in Z union this one, because there is some identifications inside X. Suppose Fx is equal to Fx1 equal to Fx2. Then Fx1, Fx2, X1 and X2 will be identified with Fx1, Fx2. Right? So it depends upon whether F is injective or not. So Z may not be a subspace of the entire thing. All right, but Y is a subspace. If the image of F is closed in a Y, it's an extra hypothesis. Then Z will be closed in AF. That means image of Z will be closed in AF. Okay, also if F is injective, then Z can be identified as image AF. If F is injective, then there will not be any identification within points of Z. Then the Z going to its class is a single point, that is each class a single point. Okay, so then Z can be identified, Z will be also a subspace. Okay, the quotient, this adjunction space is a so wide definition, it gives you lots of examples. In some special cases have their special names now. All right. Now I am going to make several claims here, which are all topological claims, which are all of easy claims, but unless you verify them each, you know, step by step, you will not give the full picture of what are these new concepts. So you have to spend that much of time, okay? So reader is requested to verify the validity of each and every claim made by the above paragraph. You have to see everything, close up space, blah, blah, blah. So you have to verify. For instance, why is J an embedding? Okay, why JY is closed subspace of AF, etc. All this, you be sure that you have verified them yourself. So we will take some special cases now. The mapping cylinder, remember just now we had defined cylinder. Now I am going to define a mapping cylinder. F from X to Y is a function. Just a continuous map, okay? Then the mapping cylinder is, first of all, on X, I have a cylinder, X cross Y. Then I take disjoint union with Y, just like I took Z cross disjoint union, Z and Y disjoint union in the adjunction space. It's Y disjoint union X cross Y. Then I have an identification, namely, X comma 1, the other one of the endpoints, is identified to Fx. Okay, for every X in X. So this is a special case of the adjunction space, namely Z is X cross I, X cross I here, and X is X cross 1. on x cross 1, think of f being identified, f being defined there. Okay, if you put z equal to x cross I and x equal to x cross 1 here in the earlier example adjunction space, you get the mapping cylinder of f. So this is a special case. This is called a mapping cylinder of f and is denoted by mf. The reader may think of this as a special case of adjunction space construction. So that's what I have told you. So here is the details of that. Before that, let me show you the picture for mapping cylinder. So you had x here and x cross I. Okay? But before that, I had a map x to y. In this picture, I'm showing x as a disk and y as just a curve here. So that is the image of f. Okay, so image of f is a curve. Y is a is this square, is the rectangle. Y is a rectangle, x is a disk. But the image is only just a curve here. Okay, the mapping cylinder is, I have taken x cross I, but at the x cross 1 does not remain as it is x cross 1, because each point x cross 1 has to be get identified with its image under f. So this point goes to this point, then x cross 1 will be identified with this point and so on. So this is the picture for the mapping cylinder MF. Okay, M for mapping cylinder of F. Okay, so there are various inclusions and so on. Because of the importance of this, let us pay some attention to this one. Just like in the case of adjunction space, there's a map J from Y to MF. It's always an inclusion because the space Y is not disturbed. Okay. There is a map from inclusion map I from X to MF. This is at X cross 0 or any other X cross tip, not X cross 1. X cross 1, there are identifications. Okay, so this inclusion is X cross 0. The I of X is X cross 0. And then there is F hat from MF to Y, F itself is extended. Okay, F hat of XT is FX. F hat of, if you take X0, it's just F. And X1, Pington 1 will get identified with all these FX. F hat of Y I have defined, it is just Y. Okay, if Y is, you know, if it is f hat of x, then this is this fx will be y, of course. So this map f hat is continuous, you have to verify. I have defined on x cross I have defined f hat like this, and on y I have defined this way. Whenever there is identification, they are okay because fx here, x comma 1 gets identified with fx. That's why this works. Okay, so f hat is an extension of x contained inside mf, f cross 0 is an extension of that. So here are the claims. I and j are embeddings. Okay, I is embedding of x and j is embedding of y. We use them to identify x and y as subspaces of MF. X and y are arbitrary spaces, there is a map between them. Now MF will include these both domain and codomain of f as subspaces of this space. Okay, so it brings them together. This is the whole idea. Now f hat defines a continuous function on MF, such that f hat composed by ix is f hat of x, is f x for every x. Check that f composite j is identity of y. So that's how we have defined it here, right? The fate of y is y. We shall soon see that in a very strong sense, the mapping cylinder can be used to devise, as a device to replace the continuous function f from x to y by the inclusion map from x to mf. What is the meaning of this replacement? We will let you know later, soon. The mapping cylinder is a special case of the adjunction space. There are some more things, we shall consider them next time. Thank you.